Alexander, and I have Mr. Quardeay Julian here with me today. So we actually asked on Facebook some questions on how to best write a romance book, and we are going to answer them for you. So we can get right into it. What's the first question, babe?
Can a romance have drama in it, or is it just about two people falling in love?
I mean, I think that they can have drama in it. I think as long as the theme is love, like that's the main storyline, I think that there can be anything else within it. That just has to be the main storyline. So like, let's say for instance, Hunger Games, that has a romance aspect to it, but it's not considered a romance because that's not the main storyline. I would consider like 50 Shades of Grey a romance book, even though there's a lot of like sex and other stuff that goes into that book. The main storyline is about ultimately two people trying to figure out like a relationship between them. What do you think, baby?
Well, I mean, along the same lines of what you said, I mean, you have to be careful not to tread a certain line when you're putting together a romance novel. There's a lot of different things a lot of different aspects that you can put into one that can still convey that storyline and convey the story you're trying to tell in regards to being a romance novel. But you just have to make sure that you're not putting too much of something else, another genre, into what you're trying to put into the romance novel. You know, when there's too much crime and too much drama, you kind of blur those lines and it becomes confusing as to what you're trying to tell the readers. So, you know, it's okay to put some drama in there. I mean, I think pretty much any type of good romance novel has some type of drama.
Yeah.
Even if it's not between the two main characters that you're trying to create a love story between.
Yeah, like we said, as long as the main storyline is ultimately about two people getting together and falling in love, then it'll be considered a romance novel. If the main story is about trying to solve a murder, but there's also romance aspects, then it would be more of a mystery novel, you know what I mean? So it really is just making sure that you're sticking to that main theme. And as long as that is present, then you can add whatever. You can add murder, you can add what drama, whatever you want to
fight
it.
Scenes.
Fight scenes.
Fight scenes is always good for a romance novel.
Yep.
The former lover and the new lover, whatever.
So. Yep. Correct. All right, what's the next question?
What is a good example of a romance book or novel?
Well,
50 Shades, of course.
50 Shades, we already named that one. A good example, so to kind of piggyback off of the other question, I'm going to plug myself here a little bit, is my book, Baby, It's Cold Outside. So that book actually deals with there's so much drama. There's also, it deals with like abuse and homelessness and all kinds of like other stuff, but the main storyline is about two people from completely different worlds that fall in love. And so that's kind of a good example of like answering the previous question, and also a great example of a romance novel.
I think Between Lovers, Eric Jerome Dickey has a lot of great romance novels. A lot of his are very straight to the point. If you wanted to check out somebody that's not only a male author, but somebody who obviously is a legend in the industry, you could always find a great romance novel with him. Obviously, I think 50 Shades of Grey, you know, like I said before, aforementioned, is a great romance novel, especially for me, because it has a lot of erotica in it.
Yeah.
You know, I would plug myself, but a lot of my novels, they don't just have romance. There's always something. It's a twist. There's always some violence or something else. So,
do you have any books that you think are romance novels? Like, that you would categorize as romance?
If I could plug one, it'd be A Thug Valentine in Brooklyn. But even that book, there's so much more that goes into that book as well than just romance. Of course, it does end with two characters getting together and finding love with each other through hardship. But between that hardship and between them finding each other, they have to deal with like the drug game, and they have to deal with, you know, violence and abusive ex-lovers mentally and physically. If you want to read anything from me that conveys that emotion and romance and that love and finding love when you think you would never find it again, that's it. How should a romance novel be structured? Are there definite rules to follow?
Just from personal experience, I think that the only definite rule is again to make sure that there's a theme of romance and that that is the main storyline. Of course, with any book that you're writing, there's going to be other, like, there's side storylines and there's, you know, other stuff that happens because that's what makes a book interesting. But as long as, like, when you're creating the plot structure of your book, those, like, points that you are creating for, like, you know, the beginning, the climax, the ending, those all have to do with, like, the main character's, you know, love story, then I think that otherwise you can do whatever you want, structure it however you want, add whatever you want.
Yeah, I think that sticking to the point that you're trying to get to with the romance is just making sure that you focus on those two characters and kind of you can, you know, create a story with another character being involved as a supporting character to create that extra bit of drama and an extra bit of, you know, whatever. But you want to ensure that you structure in this novel to tell the story and have an end game in mind as to how these two are going to end up together or how they're going to end up loving each other, but for some reason don't end up together.
Right.
You know,
right.
They don't always have to be end up together in a book, but and whatever, because sometimes romances end in tragedy, you know,
right?
And that makes the romance between those two, you know, a little bit different, but it still conveys that story that you were trying to tell in the first place. Both male and female perspectives necessary in a first person narrative, or can an author get away with just a male or just a female perspective?
Yeah, you could do just one or the other. You don't have to. You don't have to. I think for me personally, this is just me personally writing, I prefer, like, if I'm not gonna do a, like, you know, chapter to chapter point of view flop in first person, then I personally prefer doing third person.
Some of my best books have always been from one perspective, and it's usually always been from the female's perspective all the way through. So I've done a couple of books like that. I think as long as you still tell the story, you know, I think it's easier to tell a story too when you have one character telling the story to you and they know a lot, you know, you're giving a lot of details to how they met this other person. You know, back when we first met, I did this with this person. And while it is still kind of like, it's contrived because it's from one perspective, so they're telling their story and you don't necessarily know how somebody else might view it.
Yeah.
It's still, you know, if you tell it the right way, you still get the points across. So
I think one book, I don't know. I might be wrong about this, but I think that both 50 Shades and Twilight are written in first person from the female point of view. I could be wrong about that, but I know that with 50 Shades and Twilight, both authors released books after the series that were from the male perspective. So, like, it was the same story but written from the male point of view. So that's why I say that I'm pretty sure that it was written in first person from the female's point of view. So those are both books. I mean, Twilight is considered a romance. It's, you know, there's a lot of other stuff that goes into it, but, like, ultimately it's a love story, so.
What makes the perfect book, bae?
Go ahead, bae.
For me, it's a lot of my male characters always, they always have, I can't say always, but a lot of my main male characters have always had, like, a shade of toxicity to them.
Make them toxic.
But I think a couple of my main characters that were male, they weren't toxic, but they did have a lot of, like, good in them, but they just had something that was kind of steering them away from romance. Mm-hmm. So they were very poetic and very loving and very, like, just, you know, the hopeless romantic types, and there was really nothing about them that, you know, popped up that were like red flags, but they did still have something in their life. With women, it's interesting because you don't hear women always be described as a book bae.
No.
It's rare. You know, it's a rarity.
Now that you say that, yeah.
It's always a male. So
I wonder if it's just because there's a lot of female readers.
Yeah, I think that's really what it is.
I think you made a great point though. I think that toxic, like, okay, I think that flawed and toxic characters make really good book bays. And I was gonna wait to bring this character up until later because I know this question is coming, but I'll revisit it. One book bay that is, like, so controversial but, like, well known and widespread is Ethic from Moth to a Flame all the way through the Ethic series. I'm actually still reading the Ethics series. Don't judge me. I know I'm late. But I believe he's in the Butterfly series as well. I'm not 100% sure. But his character and Messiah from that series, they're both toxic. Like, Ethic done killed this woman's baby. Like, and they're in, like, toxic. But he's a book bae. Like, people absolutely love him. Christian Grey from 50 Shades of Grey. He's super flawed. He has very big mental issues and childhood traumas. And he's, you know, he's considered a book bae. So I definitely think there's something to that. Making sure that your characters are flawed and imperfect will only make people love them even more. But, like, do it in a way to where they're still lovable. Like, you want those characters to, like, find love together because you, like, you make the reader understand, like, that what they need is love, if that makes sense. So
it is a happy ending, a must.
So this is what I was talking about earlier. No, it's not a must. And you touched on that already, too. It doesn't have to always end in a wedding and a baby.
Right.
And that's something I personally need to get away from. And that's something I'm going to do my best this year to remedy. Because I feel like I'm such a sucker for happy endings. Like, that is... I love happy endings. But the book Moth to a Flame, that is... so much more than a romance novel, but it begins and ends with Raven and Ethic, and it's a tragic, tragic ending. When I say I cried, I cried so hard reading that book, but it's literally, I don't think I could ever read it again, but it's a book I will never forget, and it's now one of my, it's like my all-time favorite book. It is so good, and it's not a happy ending, but the love was there. It's evident. It was a struggle. It wasn't easy. I don't think that you need to make your characters, like, easily fall in love. That's not what makes a good romance novel. There needs to be conflict. There should be some kind of, like, resistance or, you know, whatever it might be, obstacles, in order to make it, like, great. If you think of, like, some of the great romance novels, most of them do end in a happy ending. It's not necessary, but most of them do. But within them, there were a lot of obstacles. Again, 50 Shades of Grey, there were three books of them trying to figure it out and get it right. It's not always supposed to be easy and happy. Make your readers cry.
Exactly. I mean, the only book I could think of that had the absolute most tragic ending of all my novels, well, there's two of them, but one I think I really kind of got readers with in the end was The Good Trouble for Rebecca.
I knew you were going to say
that. And that one was, people just didn't see that coming. But I think also, Never Had a Hood Love So Savage. I mean, I from the beginning to the end, without telling too many spoilers, you know, I set the story of there's a wedding happening. And I told that story all throughout this novel. That there's a wedding happening. And then when you get to the wedding, something doesn't go right, and it's just a complete tragedy. So it's like those types of, and I left off on that, you know, like I literally left off on leaving you with suspense and leaving you with questions and leaving you with tears, because I have to tell that story that not everything ends in a happy ending.
Yeah,
some fairy tales are dark, you know, and that's, to me, those are my favorite endings, because I want you to understand that in life sometimes there aren't happy endings, you know.
Yeah.
And I think those sometimes are the best books too, because you don't see it coming. You know, you think you know, like True to the Game, you know, even though the ending is, it's, that one's a little bit shade of gray, no pun intended, because that one, if you read the book and you read all the books, like, you know, obviously.
Right.
But they left you off originally thinking, like, okay, what happened there, you know?
Yeah.
So even that book is a prime example of everything that starts off glitter, you know, doesn't always turn to gold. I think that some of the best stories can be told with a very dark and twisted ending. So
yeah,
you gotta be careful though, not to always have every book like that. You know, obviously you
don't make it predictable.
Yeah, sometimes you wanna leave us off with that happy ending, because you start to become, like you said, very predictable.
Is that it?
That's it. That's it. I hope we answered these questions thoroughly for y'all.
Yes. All right. So thank you guys so much for watching. We'll see you guys next time. Thank you.